For this second part, I'm going to give you some examples specifically of arts projects with asylum seekers and refugees. Some of them from SLAM, and some of them connected in our local area, and then some other references as well for you. So, okay. So the first one is about storytelling using Aesop's fables, and it's in a Southwark day centre for asylum seekers that's been around for quite a while, and a retired psychiatrist called Dr. Morris Lipsidge has been running this programme for quite a long time, and he was, I must say actually, in my preparation for this presentation, I've been really overwhelmed with the generosity of my colleagues sharing their work. And they're very happy to be contacted as well. So Maurice is a retired psychiatrist working at SLAM, and has been working in this field for a long time. And I'm going to read you actually what he said. So it is good to hear from you. Your lecture sounds very worthwhile indeed. I've been running a storytelling group at Southwark Day Centre for Asylum Seekers for some time. The inspiration for this group came from a number of ideas and experiences which I've had when working with refugees in this country for the past 50 years. It goes without saying that their primary needs are shelter, food, clothing, medical care, safety, access to schools for their children, legal advice, and English lessons. Once these basic needs in Maslow's hierarchy are met, we have to consider the provision of worthwhile activities for people who do not have the right to work and who have lost almost everything that is meaningful in their lives. As a psychiatrist, I feel that traditional mental health activities have only a limited role in these circumstances. By contrast, the arts might help to restore a sense of meaning, of joy and humour, of pleasure and achievement in joint activities, and finding that we all share a common humanity, which helps to combat isolation and alienation. One of the guiding principles is to avoid direct questioning of people about their past lives, as they have all endured interrogations and other invasions of privacy. I've not excluded anybody on the grounds of limited knowledge of English, because we can always improvise with mime, drawing, etc. Even literacy is not a requirement. And a couple of people have confided in me after a few sessions in which they have been very quiet that they cannot actually read. The commonest first languages are Arabic and Farsi. I've chosen Aesop's fables because of their universality and brevity. And asking for a moral provokes interesting discussions and spontaneous storytelling about their past lives, including the events which led to their exile, during which people from diverse religious, ethnic, linguistic, and social class backgrounds develop a sense of solidarity and common humanity. Themes of greed, vanity, selfishness, ingenuity, and generosity and forgiveness have all emerged. So I'm going to give you two examples. The Crow and the Pitcher. I haven't really, it's actually been a real journey of discovery for me, because I didn't actually know that much about Aesop's fables. Aesop apparently was a slave, and there's sort of, he produced a number of these stories. So The Crow and the Pitcher. A crow, perishing with thirst, saw a pitcher, and hoping to find water, flew to it with delight. When he reached it, he discovered to his grief that it contained so little water that he could not possibly get at it. He tried everything he could think of to reach the water, but all his efforts were in vain, and at last he collected as many stones as he could carry and dropped them one by one with his beak into the pitcher until he brought the water within his reach and thus saved his life. So the moral of the story is, necessity is the mother of invention. So Maurice told me that A member of the day centre who has paraplegia, relies on a wheelchair, escaped across mountains strapped to the back of a mule, travelling by night while the smugglers sent his wheelchair ahead by a conventional route. The second example is of the miser and a thief. And this one, a miser, sold all that he had and bought a lump of gold, which he buried in a hole in the ground by the side of an old wall and went to look at it daily. One of his workmen observed his frequent visits to the spot and decided to watch his movements. He soon discovered the secret of the hidden treasure and, digging down, came to a lump of gold and stole it. The miser, on his next visit, found the hole empty and began to tear his hair and to make loud lamentations. A neighbour, seeing him overcome with grief and learning the cause, said, "Pray, do not give so, but go and take a stone and place it in the hole and fancy that the gold is still lying there. It will do you quite the same service, for when the gold was there, you had it not, as you did not make the slightest use of it." And so Maurice asked the group, "Is it worse to be a miser or a thief?" And they all condemned the miser. I suggested that perhaps the miser's motive is fear of having no money to live on when he is old. All except one member of the group said that they would not excuse being a miser because his children would look after him when he is an old man. The exception was a woman from Sri Lanka who tearfully described how the young people in her village had to abandon their elderly relatives to escape both the Tamil tigers and the government forces. The other members of the group, who were from Iran and Afghanistan, showed her a great deal of support. Maurice was working with another colleague, and now Rebecca McCutcheon, who is a drama, a theatre director, and she went on to then provide me some more information for your consideration as well. And I'll just read out her statement as well. One point to emphasise is that Maurice's approach of using stories to find shared territories seems to me an exemplar of good practice in this sphere. There is a growing commentary in arts practice in which the use of asylum seeker's own story has become the subject of ethical concerns. Because of the kinds of intrusions already suffered, as Maurice mentioned, and also however well-intentioned in terms of raising awareness in the public in general, or the therapeutic value of talking through trauma, the presentation of their story of escape, of survival, can almost be treated as a currency, pressurising people to narratize their experience in a way that perhaps serves others' ends, or maybe reduce their sense of themselves as more than their story. So in light of these concerns, Maurice's approach, I believe, is an excellent example of creating a light, easy entry point. Come and read a story with us, which leaves space enough for people to make their own contributions as and when they want to. She's also said that another key practical concern is worth commenting on is that the users of the day centre have very intermittent attendance. They have many other things happening in their lives which needs to be prioritised, organising accommodation, health issues, so that their regular attendance is often interrupted, sometimes for a week, sometimes for several months. So then there needs to be a structure which can be dropped into for practical reasons. It is also important in those circumstances not to open up vistas of issues for people which can't be supported. She went on to say more, and I think what I'll do is actually return to her suggestions at the end, because I'm just conscious of time and there's quite a lot of examples I want to show you. So I will come back to what she was suggesting for yourselves. this is a SLAM project run by Dr. Gemma Eek, who's a clinical psychologist, and Miriam Sarens, horticultural therapist and art therapist in SLAM. It's a particular service that's been going for a long time for asylum seekers and refugees suffering post-traumatic stress disorder. And they've been running this horticultural group in Vauxhall City Farm. They're just about to move to a different garden place, interestingly, but they've been there for a long time, and they won this fantastic award for growing localities. And so Gemma provided some information for me to relay to you. So I'll come back to that. So the horticultural project is to facilitate recovery from trauma among traumatised refugees and asylum seekers based at Vauxhall City Farm. It's to reduce social isolation, depression, anxiety, and help service users to build trust in a non-clinical environment to promote recovery from PTSD. So even though it's horticulture, I think there's a lot of creativity in horticulture, and also they incorporate some creative aspects as well in their work. So it's funded by the Morsey Charity, and they grow vegetables, planting, watering, designing the garden are integral. Many service users are asylum seekers and refugees who are survivors of human rights abuses, who have experienced war, some have been soldiers, many have been tortured in their country of origin or experienced human trafficking. Some service users are born in the UK and have complex PTSD due to severe and repeated childhood sexual abuse. The therapy approach is in line with the International Society for Traumatic Stress Studies, a phase-based approach to trauma treatment. Phase one, stabilisation, safety and symptom control. Phase two, reprocessing of trauma memories. Phase three, reintegration and rehabilitation. So the project aims to provide social support, social inclusion and community integration for some of the most marginalised people in society. The project runs over 2 days per week, during which we have use of a community garden, including a hut and a greenhouse as a community hub. On both days, service users are invited to share a healthy meal together, which often consists of food grown in the garden, such as leaves, a salad or vegetables made into soup. The purpose of this is to encourage a sense of community, healthy eating and self-care. We also encourage service users to take the produce they have grown home and also encourage them to grow their own food at home, even if it is on their balconies or window boxes. Through these activities, people are able to build trust, reduce their isolation and depression, and facilitate recovery from the most severe kinds of trauma. So it's that encouraging self-care, community connectedness, and promote well-being. Some quotes here. Before I cannot come out on my own, I'm very scared. I'm thinking someone is following me. I don't like a lot of noise around. I'm like paranoid. Then when I'm coming home here, first few weeks, my son or daughter, they have to come with me. Then slowly I get a confidence to come back, come by myself. I stand at bus stop by myself. This is a big change for me. Plantation is good. Plant tiny seed and it grows like that. Unbelievable how it relaxes me. This makes me feel I can change my life or problem. Drawing makes me feel happy and relaxed. I get stress out of me onto paper. I am creator on an adventure, like driving car for first time. Going to galleries, like visiting new country, like going to America. And Miriam went on to say that they do some therapeutic creative expression, drawing, painting, 3D modelling, using creative multi-sensory teaching methods for those with sensory impairment as well, tactile learning, accessing non-verbal learning, especially for those whom English is not their first language, creating grounding objects to use as anchor to find safe space out of clay or modelling materials, visiting art galleries and establishing links with the community. Some of the things they do. Then the second SLAM project, I briefly mentioned Creative Families, which is at South London Gallery. So it was another one of the ASOP good examples at the South Bank. So South London Gallery is a well-known contemporary art gallery, and they have an education program. And the parental mental health team, which is quite a unique service actually in SLAM, led by a psychiatric nurse team leader called Lucy Brazner and her line manager, Chris McCree, they decided they wanted to approach South London Gallery to look at a project for their mostly mothers with mental health problems and who've got children under five. And most of them are asylum seekers. And so they were funded by Guy's and St Thomas's charity, and in fact they had a big evaluation by Goldsmiths University and the Michael Rutter Centre for Research as well, again available online. So it's a visual arts programme, early intervention to improve mental well-being for parents and their children. It's free for participants and aims at promoting mental well-being by using a series of replicable artist-led workshops to engage vulnerable families in London. So it was in partnership with the Parental Mental Health Team, which is a SLAM service, South London Gallery and Children's Centres. And they did a pilot and they worked with 50 parents and 61 children took part. And the idea was to improve mental health and well-being of children and young people, an art as a catalyst for innovation. The idea was to reduce feelings of anxiety and stress, improve mood, increase opportunities for positive interpersonal relationships and creating new social networks and strengthen family bonds, increase levels of confidence and self-esteem, reduce feelings of social isolation, increase understanding of own mental well-being and increase positive coping strategies. And this is one artist, Lawrence Bradby, his work with the parents and the children. And so his is to learning to think about domestic space and the challenges of parenthood in a playful way. Activities facilitated were drawing, arranging domestic objects and transforming them, and storytelling. Activities enabled parents to reconnect with their own playfulness while sharing their feelings of everyday parenting. Parent and child sessions focused on child-led play, making bubbles, drawing with water, playing with objects. A digital camera was available for parents to take pictures of the activities during the project and display them. And there was a couple of other artists who had different styles, looking at craft, motherhood and process of making, printmaking, etc. One aspect of this was that a number of the participants faced deep structural and sociological issues, living in insecure and precarious circumstances, deemed hard to reach. They were living in lots of social disadvantages. So it was quite a hard process to develop this project, because some of the people were living in poor quality, overcrowded and temporary accommodation. They were subject to immigration control, had no access to public benefits. They experienced lone parenthood or away from family supports, unemployment, and they had children with diagnosed or undiagnosed behavioural difficulties. And the findings, because it was researched quite heavily, led on, and in fact there's another project that's happening now, it was very positive. Many of the participants noted changes and improvements in their relationships with their children, partners and other family members, positive feelings about themselves. And it's quite extensive, really, what they were able to examine, again, around the kind of collaboration between the arts and the health, and looking at risk, looking at trying to make a project work, really. So it's a fascinating process. Then the other one is the Horniman Museum, who've been great partners as well for us, as I mentioned, with JOAP and other projects. Objects handling is a big aspect to their work, and one of their community engagement workers is Dom Sergi, who's actually undertaking a PhD in this area around asylum seekers and well-being, and he's very happy to share his published work, and there's some other articles here. Horniman Museum has a strategic ethos around working with asylum seekers for their audience and participation, and I thought it was fascinating to sort of share some of this work. They have an open day for asylum seekers and refugees. The Crossing Borders 2015 is an example of that. And what they say is, the UK arts sector has worked with refugees since at least the 1970s. Nevertheless, a clear thread of arts and refugees practices have developed in response to new refugees and asylum seekers' dispersal policies. So they celebrate Refugee Week, and there are a number of projects stemming from this. They've been working in partnership with Southwark Day Centre for Asylum Seekers since 2005, and they produce this Crossing Borders work, and it's a partnership. So they run activities for the public to benefit their own, to benefit future plans to raise awareness and break down potential stereotypes within the local area. They work on this annual event 9 months before, and it's allowing more visibility of for general visitors. And then some other public showcasing. This is the Here Now. It is a co-produced exhibition of portraits in the Horniman Museum. It was last June. So it was a collaborative project in partnership with the Day Centre, the Southwark Day Centre for Asylum Seekers. And it's offered a valuable and important counter-narrative to that of the dominant public discourse by illustrating individuals' different experiences of migration to South East London. So as we were saying, really. So over 4 months, a photographer, Nana, worked alongside 10 newly arrived migrants in the local area to produce a series of portraits. And they took ownership of how they were represented. They thought about the places they were associated with in London, and they work together on these portraits. The resulting work offers visitors a glimpse into life for new arrivals, their challenges, the ups and downs, and the experiences they share with fellow Londoners, creating a space for empathy and understanding. This report is quite useful, I think. It was written about 10 years ago when there was more funding for museums. But in essence, it says, provides some ideas on how to work, how to engage with asylum seekers for the museums and to work together in partnership. So there could be barriers such as language and transport arrangements. And the idea is that you need to have staff training as well to help with that. And you need to look at different cultural differences around timekeeping and making things sustainable long-term, not a kind of one-off as well. So a number of museums in the north of England gave examples. So it might be a really useful reference for yourselves to think about when and if you start talking with museum colleagues. So I also asked an art therapy colleague around the work that she knew about, and so there's a couple of examples here. Art Refuge UK, so they had an art therapy pilot project at the Jungle Camp in Calais, in North France, and what they found was that psychosocial support was very much needed. It emphasises the importance for individuals' well-being of connections with other individuals, groups and communities, particularly the interaction between people, and it focuses on ways in which individuals and communities can become stronger and more resilient. They had an art therapy space which was full to capacity with men and teenagers in particular seeking out a safe space within which to sit alone and with others, engage in art making and begin to process some of their experiences. So the specialist training enabled her to respond sensitively to individuals' verbal and non-verbal communications, to recognise and respond to the signs of trauma and other mental health issues, and to bear witness through their images to people's traumatic stories and testimonies. The art-making space encouraged connections to be fostered between people and human experience to be shared across different languages and cultures. Over this short time, such a space already allowed a number of children and adults to start to recover some sense of meaning, agency, hope in an otherwise helpless situation, and even small amounts of joy, such as kite making. another example of art therapy museums here at MAG, and combining art therapy and mindfulness for refugees. How are we doing for time again?
Yeah, I was also thinking that you talk about the mindfulness that we have delivered.
Yes,
results.
Lovely.
Yeah.
So we can do a
so
quick...
Perhaps it's better that, now before that,
yes.
Or how you feel.
Yes, that's what I was thinking then. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I want to guide you through a quick mini mindfulness using objects. Dom, who I mentioned at the Horniman, they have lots of objects, all sorts of objects at that museum to handle as part, and there's actually quite a lot of work evidence around objects and well-being anyway, that sensory experience. And so I asked for something that you could all hold. I'm not sure if you've all got a stone, but I thought I'd just do a quick example of this. Mini mindfulness using objects.
Oh, so, sorry if I ask. If I ask, is everybody has the stone?
Yes, yes.
So do everybody have? Tai onko kaikilla tämä kivi, mikä on jaossa tuolla? Ja tämä on vielä saatavilla, jos joltakin puuttuu. Hänellä on.
Just out of interest, do any of you have any of you experienced objects handling in a museum here at all? Anybody? Do you have museums that might have objects, collections that you can handle at all? Yes, yes. And do you know of groups that have gone and attended those sessions at all? Oh, yeah, good. Yes. Brilliant. So, so we all have a stone. So this guide is saying it's to focus attention, something that you do not have strong feelings about, actually. So first explore it visually to yourself. Describe what you see in ways that refer to the inherent qualities of the object, not judgments of interpretations. Is it small? If small is a judgment. Well, about 1 inch, sorry. So, what does the surface look like? What is its shape? How does the light illuminate its surface? Is it straight, curved, or some combination? Is it shiny or dull? Are there shadows across it? Any reflections on its surface? What color and shade does it have? Does it look smooth or bumpy? Does it look soft or hard? Does it look wet or dry? What else can you see about it? Now I want you to close your eyes in order to focus better on your sense of touch. How does it feel as you hold it in your hand and run your fingers across it? Is it hard or soft? Smooth or rough, sharp or dull, rigid or pliable? How much does it weigh? What is its temperature? How does it feel different to different parts? Then take a moment to reflect on your tendency to hold on to or reject certain emotions. Did it work? How did it affect your experience of the emotions? So just, I suppose it's just a small example of going back to the five ways of well-being. Take notice, slow down, and learning and connecting. So there's all sorts of objects and all sorts of ways of applying mindfulness through the arts, actually. So we'll have a move on now. So this is another project, a SLAM project, but Tree of Life is actually an international model. It came originally from Africa. And it's something that you might like to consider. It's very much about collaboration, co-production, the voice of the service user. And so Tree of Life originated in East and Southern Africa, particularly with people affected by the social and emotional impact of poverty, conflict, HIV and AIDS among children and the youth. So colleagues have now using this model, and the woman in the picture is a psychologist, and she's shared some of her work with service users, and we have a lovely film to show you. So we'll get that ready. And it was another project funded by the Morsi Charity as well. And it was, so it's Dr. Julie Fraser and some other psychologists and other service users on the wards in the different hospitals in SLAM, using this Tree of Life principle. And this film really sums it up. So it's about 12 minutes long. Yes.
Life is based on narrative therapy. It's basically about the stories that we tell about ourselves. It originated in Zimbabwe, like I say, because the tree there is a symbol of healing, and they used it in communities there to help traumatized communities get over very difficult periods, war-torn, HIV, poverty, to overcome these kind of multiple traumas that they were using. And it is used all over the world.
Hi, I'm Ursula Joy, and I'm a mental health service user. I also co-facilitate the Tree of Life workshops. The roots of the tree represent where we come from. What would your root be, Julie?
Well, I would talk about coming from the seaside in Scotland and where I spent a lot of time growing up, special places.
Next, we would draw the ground, and the ground represents where we are now.
The trunk of the tree represents our skills, our abilities, anything that you think you're quite good at, or things that people have noticed about you that you're good at.
And the branches are our hopes and dreams. The leaves are the special people in your lives. They can be alive or dead, role models, heroes, anybody at all, anybody you aspire to, or somebody that's helped you through difficult times.
After we've drawn our own trees, we present back. So we would hold up our tree, for everyone in the group to see, and we would share the parts of our story with everyone in the group. And this is, for me, the most powerful part of the workshop, because this is where connections are made within the group.
And this is a really important part from the model in Zimbabwe where they used it, that the community put together their trees and they celebrated that forest, and they tried to rebuild the communities after traumas that they all experienced. I think that part, connecting to the narrative therapy, narrative theory behind it, is it's called the thickening of the story. So you have what people maybe have, especially in mental health services, this problem-saturated, dominant story, and there's a hidden story, and the tree helps them uncover that. It encourages people to tell a positive story, and it's actually very difficult for people, especially in mental health services, to tell a positive, preferred story of themselves.
Yeah, I don't see how you can work in mental health without the service user experience. This idea that there are experts in theoretical models, it's a one-dimensional view, and I don't think that's the way to work, because mental health is all about relationships and understanding, and you can do that really beautifully when working together, coming from different backgrounds with different experience.
Good as a service user who's only kind of been having one-to-one sessions to meet not only other service users with, you know, completely different lived experiences to myself, but also to meet other professionals.
Yeah, I think there's definitely more of a turn towards more collaborative service user led care.
That I feel personally as a mental health, proud mental health service user, I feel valued, I feel cherished.
We can't deny that there are really good results coming from this sort of work.
Rather than the trust corporate induction, let's get everybody into the recovery college and learn about working mental health that way.
Freaking awesome.
Yeah?
I like that a bit.
Great idea.
Actually, it's shorter than I remembered. So recovery college, again, is another aspect to the work that's advocated in UK. I'm not sure if you have recovery colleges here. Very much it's about co-production in learning. So you have a person with lived experience of mental health problems delivering training with a professional with a clinical experience. So we have a recovery college, and they're suggested as a really good model across the UK, really, and most of them are related to mental health trusts. So recovery college was mentioned there, and that building is one of the places they run the courses, and there are all sorts of recovery college courses around sort of mental health awareness and how to manage your mental health, etc., etc. So and Tree of Life is associated program. And then some of the lovely slides Julie sent me. This other video there is from the origins of Tree of Life in Africa, which we can show you, or you can have a look at another time. She mentioned about narrative therapy and life is multi-storied. We live our lives according to the stories we tell ourselves and the stories we are told by others. The person is not the problem. The problem is the problem. People have many skills, competences, beliefs, values, commitments, and abilities that will assist them to change their relationship with problems in their lives. And then the origins of Tree of Life. Tree of Life manual. There's an organization called REPSSI, REPSSI. Is a non-profit organisation. You can look for the origins of Tree of Life. And there's roots and ground, trunk, leaves, fruits, flowers, branches, and the forest of life. We're actually trying to exhibit the work, actually, in the Maudsley Hospital. And that's a big thing, actually, I meant to say, is trying to showcase these projects that have been really heavily invested in regards to people's time, commitment and funding. So the Creative Families project I mentioned, just about to have that exhibited in the Maudsley Hospital in our main corridor. And so that needs a bit of funding to make that happen, to be curated properly. And actually the Alchemy project, the dance project, that's showcased in the Maudsley Hospital. And I think that has a way of trying to advocate for what we do, and the having a constant reminder of the of images and text and the research. So I think we've got images here in the exhibition here. So I think it's really important to showcase the work. There's another guide here, quite an extensive one, which is useful. Somebody, Maria Lokowant, Inclusion Through Art, an organisational guideline to using the participatory arts with young refugees and asylum seekers. And so the definition, just to kind of clarify that, participatory arts, listening to young people, giving them space to articulate their own concerns and taking into account the children's maturity and capacities, enabling them to take part in the planning, conduct and evaluation of activities within or outside the family sphere, which may imply involving them in decision making. Participation can be a vital and powerful ingredient in helping refugee young people change their often very negative images of themselves and in the process raise their sense of self-esteem. Involving young people actively as participants might help them to value themselves as people who are contributing both to their families and wider society. So if you have a chance, you could have a look through, but some recommendations and different examples of theatre work, photography work, working with young refugees and asylum seekers. And the portraits there. And then some other examples funded by Paul Hamlin, Platformer. They had at the South Bank, which is at that festival hall on the South Bank in the middle of London, they had a part of the Festival of Love. They had this Good Chance Theatre encampment project, which is really good around public engagement praxis, and other examples of resources and ideas. Then talking again around sort of dispelling negative stereotypes, and in the UK we have probably, you know, there's lots of negative stories about asylum seekers and refugees, unfortunately. And this I found in The Guardian, one way of artists trying to kind of, in a way, sort of populate their areas with these little boats with stories about asylum seekers and refugees to present a different way of challenging derogatory language and misinformation. So these paper boat art project, which is, they're populated in bus stops, trains, and all sorts of random places. It's a really interesting idea. And then we're at the end. We've got through all the different stories, I hope. Bit of a, you know, sort of thank you very much for your listening and watching, and I hope you've been inspired and things that you can adapt. Any questions, really?
One thing what came up yesterday, it was actually at lunch time that somebody commented that sometimes, like in Finland, this is quite new thing that we have big amounts of asylum seekers and refugees, even if we have had tens of years refugees and asylum seekers is, but now many people got very activated or became very eager to help.
Yes.
Which is a very positive thing, and it's important to know the people and not read about them or hear, but just to actually get to be friends and know, very normal. But there has been sometimes a problem that people are eager to give something, the newcomers are not really to take. So that even if we think that the tree of life or this boat or this art, this is really the great thing. But in the way, have you had any problems with that the people whom you are trying to give these things are not eager to take them? And like we heard from the music presentation this morning, that they had places available for the dance course, but they didn't have the immigrants there. So do you have any comments on that?
Yes, in fact, this publication is really useful for how to get over those challenges of people not turning up. And it's being about being very flexible and kind of having sort of things in place that allow for people not turning up. And for example, if you're building up, again, it's about the trust and the relationship. So, for example, what they advocate is not just sending letters or emails to the recipients. You need to go and go to the day centre and make face-to-face contact and to build up trust, and so that they get to understand that it's not being imposed on them. They can contribute if they want to. And that I recognise that in the Horniman project, the portraits, the photographer in, I've got it here as well, in her documentation of how she went through it, she went a lot of hours going to the day centre to meet the people, build up trust and follow, you know, and invite them to take part. So it's a slow process, and I think that's one example is the face-to-face.
And so it's not enough to put an ad on the web pages, so that you have to do something.
And anyway, in mental health, anyway, you have people that don't turn up for one reason or another. You have to remind them. I think some people do use text as a reminder, for example. But I think it's definitely about the fostering relationships, building up the trust, and reminders, and engaging people as part of the process. So they. I think throughout, really, it's about that co-production. So they, so Horniman Museum, very keen on skills, you know, opportunities to share and to be part of the process of making an open event, public event. So it's people being able to contribute and being part of the process of making, if you see what I mean. So it's, yeah, I think that's, there's lots of ways. I
liked very much one of your slides before the break, that there was that facilitate, don't deliver.
Yeah.
But is there, I think, if somebody in the audience want to say, comment or ask, also in Finnish, so we can translate. So, and or does somebody want to tell Helen about the good examples and or comment something?
I would like to ask about the language issue, because here in Finland almost nobody who comes to Finland for the first time, they don't speak any Finnish. So what about in your projects, have you needed interpreters? Because if I'm thinking like here, if we had such groups and if we have different nationalities, then there would be always that problem of language, that we should have an interpreter for each language group. So I think, have you solved that problem, or do they speak already so good English?
From what the facilitators say, is that's the advantage of having arts, is that you can find other ways, like Dr. Maurice Lipsidge says they use, sort of artwork or sort of just finding a way to explain stuff. And so other people also help to explain things. And so using images or using gestures and, you know, through making and doing, you can kind of find ways to communicate. I'm sure there are different ways to get interpreters in as well, but I think probably that's the advantage of doing together, because actually it's quite symbolic to kind of use dance or music, because that is a way of non-verbal work, really, isn't it? So,
I've got a microphone already. Yeah, so that's exactly what I was thinking earlier, what you asked about people not coming there. Because we've had some kind of art workshops in our centre.
But the where in Finland?
In Saarijärvi, in an asylum seeker centre. And I think the trust at the centre is quite good. The kind of the center is quite good in that way, that we kind of communicate a lot. But the problem was that nobody was coming there. Maybe one or two guys, because they are young guys. But then I think my opinion is that the problem was that kind of they didn't want to have kind of an art thing. So then we found something else. It was dancing. It was music. It was that kind of thing. So I think that was much better. The art was the problem.
Yes, and I think that's with probably a lot of people. They might be very afraid of being exposed as a not very good artist or something, but there are all sorts of ways of people might want to do animation, making, you know how you can make animation these days now so easily, or digital sort of contributions and things like that, so filmmaking. And I think they're finding something that's very suitable for those people. Yeah.
Can I still comment shortly? Yeah, and then another thing I was thinking about, kind of, for example, the Tree of Life. For some people, it might be really difficult. It depends on the stage where they are in their own process, kind of how much they've processed their own life. So even kind of saying things at some point might be too much or kind of thinking.
Yeah. And I think in that group context as well, it's up to the person how much they share and how much it's, how well facilitated it is. But actually with having it co-facilitated by a service user helps with that balance and to kind of allow for that safe contribution and engagement. I said I would mention some ideas the theatre practitioner had working with the Aesop's Fables and with working with Dr. Lipsitch. So I thought I'd just perhaps read that out just for you to think about as well. So she said, for your conference, I suggest you might want to get your audience working in smaller working groups for a few minutes. Perhaps you could locate some Finnish myths and some myths from your own childhood and ask each of the group to explore one together, nominating a facilitator to encourage everyone to contribute and to explore reflective listening and to feedback to the group on how you feel that the moral of the story was. So I'm not sure if we've got time today to do that, but it's something for you to think about how to adapt Finnish myths if you wanted to do this sort of storytelling work and the moral of the story. And another thing was to look at, which was quite important, was to get a map and reflect on the diversity of the diversity. So most groups of asylum seekers will include people from a number of different cultures, but often regional proximity. So you could have looking at a map and looking at kind of where they originated from. They felt that that was quite an important thing as well, the geography.
One thing I have been thinking the whole morning is that there's one thing covered very little so far today is the children. And like, I'm a child psychiatrist, so I think when you work with the children, the creativity, play, drawing, it comes automatically. You can't work with children without. And perhaps for this, it came up that how to get people to join is that in the camps and places where you have children, that when you do with the children something, then the adults can join.
And I think with creative families at South London Gallery, it was around having art groups in the children's centre and then into the South London Gallery and having worked together. So actually it was a kind of family participation, with the artists.
One thing I would like to ask from the audience is that there are special methods, there are special projects, but how have you, any of you, like, done or find ways or have ideas how we could apply all this art culture for our everyday work, as you work as a nurse or doctor, and to do it not only so that we talked before break that you could contact with the local organizations and work with them. It's one thing. But the other thing is that we heard about this interview by Katinka, that how to use pictures or interviews. But perhaps you could tell something about that. But does anybody has any examples how to apply culture in the everyday work with all the clients or most of the clients?
Hello, do you have to stand up? Well, anyway, I work in an asylum seeking center in Vanta. It's a refugee center for only men. And I felt that in my work, one of the things that have helped me is kind of normalize arts as not maybe like a huge thing, but just approaching it by very simple things. And we are a center with only men, which is a real challenge in the aspect that maybe crafts and those kind of things are not as much seen as an activity for men. But I felt that, like, just being brave enough to just like bring those kind of things. One of the things that our clients most like is coloring, and I've had a lot of workshops with, like, we keep them every Sunday, where we used to put music on, and we had like relaxing coloring sessions, and also like just putting music, the clients will just like approach, like they, it's I think here in Finland maybe people don't express themselves as easily through music that people from other countries, and that's a very powerful tool. Well, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, I think kind of it made me think about Dom Sergi at Horniman Museum was saying kind of it's really crucial to kind of enable everyday kind of ordinary sort of things. So it really resonates with what you're saying, actually. So rather than sort of concentrating on people being traumatized and the medicalization, actually it's really useful to kind of really embrace the everyday, the ordinary, and so it's celebrating life and, you know, sort of sharing. So I think that's really important, actually, finding a simple things, really. Yeah. And hence the moral, the Aesop fables are very simple, and people can apply their own story to that and then share, and that commonality is important.
Yes, I'm an art psychotherapist from Helsinki University Hospital. And I was thinking that using the museums and art museums is to go and visit there. So there is also you can have some conversations in the place of there, and probably afterwards, and then the emotions and feelings, what they bring up, and yeah, you can share with those things. Yeah. And I think that's very nice. Mm. Way to approach art in the ordinary life.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, the particular one I mentioned about JoApp, which can be applied with any client group going to galleries and taking part in participatory artwork, so art workshops. So, for example, at Dulwich Picture Gallery, we have a guided tour looking at the pictures, and people... anybody can contribute and look at the pictures and say, well, what does that remind them of? So it's kind of trying to encourage everyone to take part in looking at the work. And my colleague, who's the Trustwide Arts Therapies advisor, she really wants to see what else we can do, what more we can do around that, to take it back to the ward and to use the stories in the pictures. And in fact... there's, particularly in America, they've got quite a big practice around the use of galleries for educating health professionals, doctors, and in a way, a mindful way of looking at pictures and trying to tell the story so you can use observational skills. So there's a whole other realm of work around use of galleries. For all of us, really, that slow looking and telling stories, and people taking part in that.
Yeah that's right.
First of all, thank you, Helen, for a huge amount of methods you mentioned. There's a lot of us to learn about Finnish culture and art workers. There has been an increasing group for them. For example, Taiku Sydän organization, PIPO, the art center in Lempäälä, and then we have that kind of association like Terveyttä Kulttuurista association. And they have very many projects among there. I was very pleased about that wheel of health, wheel of well-being. I think when we are creating our model, the national model of mental well-being for refugees, maybe we can use something from that. For example, layout, something very, very useful for us. Yes. And then one thing. I was very pleased about those videos. It was nice to see those real people talking about them, their situations and their lives. Mm. For example, I think that blonde lady who was talking about the trust, we heard yesterday about trust a lot, and a man talking about activities of daily living, very remarkable when we are thinking about refugees and they moving here, totally new country.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you.
And
yeah, as you mentioned, this visual expression interview that I mentioned during my presentation, I will still clarify to avoid misunderstandings. Even though I said, and many people here said, that art is creating bridges and facilitating the communication, and it's like there are many nonverbal ways to communicate. Still, in a psychiatric interview, we always need an interpreter when we make a diagnosis, no matter if there is a visual interview, visual expression interview. So it helps a lot, but it's not enough if we make a psychiatric assessment. And yeah, everybody can, if you are interested in this visual expression interview, it's published in English there in Psychiatria Fennica, where our team, cultural psychiatry team from Helsinki University Central Hospital, has also published an interesting article about assessment of refugees. Thank you.
Okay. Hello, and thank you very much for a very interesting show. Okay, we are working in SIPO, in the house for young refugees. And I did have to say about, because I was listening about the problems of getting young people involved. So I think the best thing here is the trust, and it's very slow work. In my other work, I have worked about 20 years with the kids in troubles, and among the theater and art is number one. And this was very nice because I was comparing this work to another. So we have really tried to make art. And I think one of the part of the art, it was successful. And I think it was painting and writing stories and the trees and everything, more or less the same. But the most difficult, it was theater, because these kids, they are very traumatized, and it was very difficult to work. And I think that 1 year is nothing. So.
Yeah.
Must go on working. But thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, now we have the last comment. Finnish
Feel
people
sometime.
Are warming up a little bit slowly.
Okay, thank you very much for the presentation. I work for Save the Children Finland, and we run a project in 4 different reception centers in Finland around the whole country. And the aim of the project is to support children's psychosocial well-being. And we use arts in different way in our activity, and we have found that very useful also in the way that we get really valuable information from the children, like through their drawings, what they draw basically. There is a lot of, sometimes there is a lot of violence, like weapons, soldiers, but that is a really good way for them to reflect their previous experiences, which is difficult. I mean, otherwise we would have difficulties in receiving that kind of information directly from them due to language problems and others. And also we have noticed that using art is really important in strengthening the relationship between children and their parents. So what we have noticed in our work was that in the beginning, their parents, they were not that much involved. But as the time goes on, the parents have started to become more active also. And now we have seen that the parents, they come and they join the activity with the children, and it's really nice development to see. Yeah. Thank you.
Brilliant. Yeah.
Okay. And now we have to conclude this session, and then after thanking Helen, I have some practical issues, so don't leave yet the room, and then we change to Finnish. But thank you, Helen, very much. You took your time, and it's very hard to travel and stay in the airport and so
oh,
on.
Oh, pleasure.
No.
It's fine.
This was very good catalyst, as you said in one of your slides, that to be catalyst. And
yes,
it's,
absolutely.
I think this is for the Finnish active people working here. They get hints and encouragement to continue their work who already do. And now we thank you, the Paloma Group, thanks you with the book, This is Finland. So now
Lovely.
You know everything
thank
about
Finland. Thank you very much. Thank you.
That's all.
And if you do want to have further information, as I said, or contact with any of those facilitators or further documents, do let me know, you know, if you would like that. Thank you. Thank you again for having me. It was a pleasure to come here.
Thank you.